Moving forward, ladies and gentlemen, our next panel discussion is on transforming the gender equation in corporates, a perspective from women leaders. To set the context and moderate the discussion, may I please invite on stage once again Mr. Vijay Ramachandran, Editor-in-Chief, IDG Media, on stage. Please give him a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Could we have a maple mic?
Mysterious. So, according to the United Nations, women, and that's very strange for most of you sitting out here, women do 66% of the world's work, own 40% of businesses, and produce 50% of the food, yet they are gravely underrepresented in leadership positions in organizations such as yours. So we thought we would ask some women leaders what really got them to those positions, how they really dealt with it, are there cultural sensitivities at work here, and why there are so few women leaders. I would rather that you heard from them than me. Shubhi, all yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming on stage our panelists, Dr. Reena Ramachandran, Member Ad Hoc Task Force, Department of Performance Management, Cabinet Secretariat, Government of India, and former Chairperson and MD of Hindustan Organic Chemicals. Please give her a huge round of applause, Dr. Reena Ramachandran. Our second panelist, Aruna Rao, Group CTO, Kotak Mahindra. Please give her a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome up on stage, Ms. Aruna Rao.
Please.
Our next panelist, Melissa Reyes, GM, Pivotal, Asia Pacific and Japan, ENC. Please give a huge round of applause to Kirti Patel, CTO, Kotak Life Insurance. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, our panelists for this session. Please enjoy.
You know, I thought I'd start not from asking about why there are so few women in leadership positions, but I thought I'd ask you all to go over what really made you successful and what really got you to those positions that you're occupying right now. So if we can start with you, Dr. Ramachandran, and then we'll take it around.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. Can you hear me? Is it okay?
I think now.
Can you hear me? it was not a very deliberate effort to reach to the position. It all happened as the career was building up. Getting married early in life, you need to obviously tag along where the husband goes, and along with that have children in between on the way, and then upgrade yourself in terms of knowledge and qualification. And one lesson I learned was, never say no to any opportunity comes your way. So I have changed quite a bit in terms of switching jobs, doing different things, and basic fundamental factor is learning the art of learning. So you learn new things and then go from there. So I am a pure researcher, having done 2 doctorates in chemistry, drug chemistry, and I landed up in administration finally in the public sector and the government. It was not an easy task to get into administration from a research background. But I found it extremely interesting to learn. I used to bring files home And I didn't even know, I had no training as to how cabinet notes are written, how notes are prepared on the file. And my minister was Mrs. Gandhi at that time, because I worked in the public sector. It was a challenge. And I think it's only the drive to learn things, and it never ever in the career that ever I would say that anything came on my way. I wouldn't really say there was a bias or there was something else, as normally we keep discussing, a lot of articles are written on that. So if you really want to do something, you do come up with solutions and achieve your objective. There was a support that was available from the family, which I think is a major help in the Indian context. Normally the questions are asked as to, do you receive support from your colleagues? I headed a company where they did not have a single woman, single one. Now the question is, how do you elicit support? You need to acquire, you need to get the support from the people. Don't expect directly someone to support you. It's just based on your performance, based on your knowledge, based on how much you know about what you're doing, and be very transparent. Of course, there is no substitute for that. So people watch a lady with much more attention in every action that she does, you know, at the workplace. And this is because when you are in minority, there is a big reason for you to be there, and they'll keep watching you, both at personal as well as in the official position. So the extent to which you are in a position to conduct yourself in a dignified manner, professionally honest and professionally good, I think it's a simple results demonstration. So at every level, I will end up by saying that at every level in the career, I made sure that I made changes in the jobs where I could demonstrate the capabilities better, where there could be better target achievement and measurable targets. And when you go to a new job, to demonstrate the achievement of targets in a short span so that the organization is able to see the merits in your being there and show results. So ultimately, there is no shortcut. There are no alternatives to the performance. It's only the performance which takes one forward. I've been very fortunate to be having an extremely exciting career for myself.
Aruna?
So good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. So for myself, I think it's quite similar to what Dr. Ramachandran said. You start off like everybody else, going through an education. And once you finish that, it's only common sense that you use it by getting into the workforce. And you start working hard, like all people, apply yourself, and keep going at it. I think you have to stay in the game, you know. And the most important thing for me is that I found that I had to be excited and interested in what I'm doing. So what's driving you is your own desire to get whatever it is done, to achieve something new. And I guess I was lucky that I got lots of opportunities to do different things, take on different roles. So you keep, that is the big drive. And I think this is probably the same for both women and men. And the only additional part, like Dr. Ramachandran said, is in terms of having the support. You need to have the support on the family front, willingness of people to provide you the time and, you know, be flexible to work around your time. And that's the support that I did get. And other than that, it's a question of being interested in doing new things and achieving new heights. And I think that's probably one of the most important things.
Sure. Okay. Melissa?
Sure. Like Dr. Ramachandran, I didn't start out thinking that I needed to go through a certain path and achieve a certain number of things. So I was working quite happily, and one day I was lucky enough to have a male colleague who was part of the leadership team come to me and say that he really thought I had potential to progress within the organisation. He said, I can see a lot of raw talent, and I'd really like you to come join my team and work with me to you know, to actually get to the next level. So, you know, I think one of the things that you often don't recognize your own capabilities. So I was actually excited to do that. And, you know, he really mentored me. And some of the things that I learnt there was, you know, if you don't ask, you won't get. And you also need to ensure that you're actually promoting, in a subtle way, promoting what you're achieving. I was listening to a YouTube video about a lady that used to work at Ernst & Young, and she was passed over for a promotion. And what was interesting about that is she went in the next day and said, hey, I'm not really sure why I didn't get the promotion. I've achieved this, 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 and this. And the manager said, I wasn't aware that you'd achieved all those things. So you always have to do it subtly, but you do need to promote what you've achieved. And then I think the last thing is, you know, where there's a downturn or where there's change, there's always opportunity, and you need to be open to that opportunity. And so again, in that same organization, the company that I was working with was actually going through Chapter 11. They were essentially bankrupt, and they had investors that came in. And I was given the opportunity to go move to Chicago and be in a global role. So out of that opportunity, it's really helped me progress my career. I've jump-started my career. So be open to opportunity, be open to change, be passionate about what you do. And I really think that you need to have a sponsor and mentors in your career.
Sure. Kirti?
When I decided to join engineering about 25 years ago, more than 25 years ago, my father said, are you really serious about it? Because if you just want to do engineering and not use the skills that you have learned, then you are being very unfair to a male student who doesn't get admission because you took that admission. And that has remained with me throughout my career, okay? So basically, you know, so that taught me that I can't differentiate myself because I'm a woman. I have to work equally hard. So you asked what we did differently. I would say we have all done exactly what you all have done to reach the position that you are at. We didn't expect any differentiation. We put in same amount of hard work. We were passionate about our work, and that's why we are where we are today. The other thing, very important thing, is the support from family, which Aruna mentioned. Support from society is also equally important. The third thing is that you have to make choices. And if you believe that you want to do well in your career, then maybe you have to let go of a few things which you would have done if you were not working. And this is a choice that a woman has to make. And once she has made that choice, she's to stick to it. So that's the third thing that I did.
One of the things, Kirti, when you were talking earlier, you very specifically mentioned that initially there is a fair offtake into corporates, but in the mid-manager level, suddenly, you know, women drop out or choose not to make career just their focus in life. And I'm sure you've had members of your team that you've had drop out of that. Why do you think this is happening? Is this primarily a societal thing, or is it about individual choice at the end of the day?
So if I look at my team, then, you know, none of my reportees are females, okay? So there's no pipeline. But at the entry level, 25% of my team members are female. So yes, women are taking up professional courses. They are entering corporates. But as I said to you earlier, at the mid-management level, they're dropping off. It could be due to societal pressure, family pressure, but I think that it is also more the women who are deciding to drop off. They are somehow either not taking on the initiative or staying put where they are. They don't want to take that additional responsibility because, as I said, it's a matter of making choices. So if you really want to do well only with your family, your kids, and you don't want to spend enough time here, then you will tend to either drop off or stay put wherever you are. The other thing that makes a difference is at the entry level, you use your core skills, okay, which perhaps a woman is good at. At the mid-management level and above that, you have to do things differently. You have to work with different people, maybe more males than females. You have to go out, you have to talk to different people. Perhaps that is where the woman is not coming out in the open and doing things differently.
Okay. One of the things you mentioned, Melissa, was about this person who really mentored you. Now, a mentor at work is good to have, whether despite or irrespective of your gender. How did this really pan out? What did that person really do? Did they really push you beyond what you were comfortable with?
Yeah, I think they did. They certainly, the way that he approached it is, rather than telling me how to do things, he gave me projects and I would go away and work on those projects and then come back and we would actually brainstorm about it. So it's, you know, it's the old classic situation where you actually learn by doing and then by discussing afterwards. So he was very good at doing that, and it was a passion for him, and so it worked out very, very well.
One of the things, Dr. Ramachandran, and we were talking earlier also, is that women seem to lack role models. Now, one part is if you are lucky enough to get a mentor, then things are good, again, irrespective of gender. But for women in the workforce, not having other role models as women, how much of an issue is that?
I think,
Mike,
in India, it hasn't, only we've started talking about it now, that women need to be networking more, there should be more mentoring for women, there should be more visibility, you know. But most of the research work and surveys have been done in the Western world more than anything else, and this survey, which was done quite some time back, it identified mentoring as a very important factor. But I mean, in my generation, if you talk about connected with me, we had not even known what is called as mentoring, absolutely. And in many companies, even today, in public sector, there is nothing very clearly specified as mentoring. And secondly, about the role models. Well, I think it's, I always tell the young people today that why should you have a role model in the first place? Because the markets are changing so fast. And I always admire the young people who are coming up. I mean, all of you are in that category now. But you do your things and jobs and finding solutions to the problem, which are much more complex than what we used to have in our times, and do a good job. So why do you have to look for a role model? Because it's sometimes we live too much in the past. And it can give you wrong kind of information and wrong perceptions about things. And I, first of all, never had that issue of having anybody as a role model. Where do you think a housewife who is working will ever have time to think about all these things? You're so busy with your own household things, looking after the kids, sending them to school, preparing them, and then go to work on a regular 9-to-5 job, and then looking for your career building for future. And so it's too much of engagement that woman has on a day-to-day basis that you don't have time to think about role models. All these are all new things which have happened. So I personally don't attach much significance to it. The young generation is doing extremely well in a very complex business environment, and I think they should demonstrate themselves as role models if they have to really come up in their own career, and find what is the best option for them and generate the best kind of results which are possible.
You know, you mentioned, and I think this is very critical, in an Indian context, I think the pressures on women at work, there is, despite all of the family support, I think there is a certain requirement or an ask from both society and family that you spend a lot of time also with family, with kids, with your husband, with other relatives and things like that. So I don't know, one of the other things is, does this impact the way that women actually build networks? This wouldn't be a question in the case of a man. A man would just go ahead and possibly do it. I'm not sure whether everyone's good at networking, but they would at least make an attempt. And I'm not sure whether the same thing happens in the case of a woman in the workplace.
It's extremely important to network. I think women will have to make themselves visible, make an identity for themselves, build a brand for themselves, and spend that extra time outside their workplace. And I've done that consciously in the last 30, 35 years. Very few women will find time to participate in extra activities other than their own profession. To be a part of a cultural program, to be as a part of a sports event or anything else, seminar, conference. Whenever I used to have women programs, they will always say, oh, we'll have to go home, husband will be coming back, and then we have to get busy with the evening dinner, and all kinds of. There are umpteen reasons not to attend. Now, that is a place you're noticed most, and I always advise the young women that they must take their time off, however difficult it is, because visibility is extremely important, and you are better noticed outside your workplace. Because you are expected to do what you are expected to, you're paid for that, and that's your profession. Everybody knows you in your circle. But you become known much more, and I can tell you there are umpteen examples, I'll not name them here. In here itself, the current CEOs in banking industry, in other sectors, in IT, financial services, all of them have practiced this. So networking is, in my opinion, the topmost priority. The women must attach significance. Whether it is an official function, whether it is a social function, whether it is a family function, even there they must network, even if it's a family function.
Sorry, Aruna, similar thoughts?
Sort of. But before I get into that, you know, you mentioned that there's an expectation that women should spend more time with family and other kind of things. I think that, again, is, as Kirti said, really dependent on the individual. There is, yes, it is the norm that women spend more time with family, children, and things like that. But eventually, it's up to the individual, you know, how they want to do. So that can be balanced. And on the professional side, on the networking, I think it's as essential as, you know, for anybody. It's the only way you find out what's going on outside, what other people are doing, the way you want to benchmark yourself. Those things are absolutely essential. The only reason I would say it becomes a little more difficult for women is I think the men do have an, you know, old boys network kind of thing. You know, you have people who graduated from you from school, so you have that batch system of people whom you stay in touch with and things like that. So unless you've been in the same locality and kept up with some of your, you know, old batch, I think that's the only piece that makes it slightly, you know, more difficult for women to keep up. But otherwise, I think networking with your colleagues and staying abreast of things is as important for everyone.
So one of the other things, Kirti,
wanted to add something here. So when my daughter was young, I used to, you know, quickly have lunch at work in 10 minutes because I wanted to catch up on work and go home on time. So never really mixed with people. And then I realized that I am missing out on a lot of things. So women have to take that extra effort, you know, consciously go out of their way, because it may not come to them naturally to just call a few male colleagues and say, let's go out for lunch or let's have lunch together. So that is extremely important. So what both of them have said is important, but I'm, to the very few women that are there in the audience, I'm saying you have to take that extra effort, okay? Be it in networking or be it with the responsibilities at home. Because though we said that we need support from family, at the end of the day, it is still, unfortunately or fortunately, the responsibility lies with the woman. So you have to put that extra effort. You can't always compare with a male colleague. If you want to be successful, you have to do both these, manage to do both.
One of these things, Melissa, is about, you know, Aruna talked about this old boys club, but part of networking is also trying to be one of the boys. And you know, the boys talk about different things. It can be about sport, and it can be about completely different things. Not very easy to crack for a woman. Not very easy for a woman to get part of that old boys club, right?
So I think being Australian, we grow up with sports, and so in terms of sports with men, that's an easy one. No matter, you know, as you move into more senior roles, you have to have a broad understanding on what's going on across the board, across a number of topics. And especially when you're in Asia Pacific, global roles, you need to look outside your own little area of domain, your own country, your own function, and have a broad understanding of a variety of topics that allow you to talk with different people You know, I talk with different people in different countries. You talk to women, you talk to global leaders, you talk to people that are different parts of the organization. So if you actually want to be successful in senior management, then you have to be have at least some sort of understanding of a variety of topics. Of course, there's certain things that, you know, women actually like to talk about and men like to talk about different things. That's just the reality. So you need to embrace being a woman as well as be an expert or at least have an understanding of what's going around a number of different topics.
Yeah. One of the interesting things, Kirti, that I find that particularly in your sector, which is banking and financial services, most of the CIOs, male or female, tend to come from banking or financial services, from the business side of things. You're one of the few engineers out there. And interestingly, the statistics on that is not very nice. So a third of the women who graduate engineering school never work. Another close to a third, a little over a third, end up in academia. So which leaves just about a third for the corporates, for industry. And there, women engineers tend to get into things like legal and finance and HR, not really IT. Why do you think that is so? Is there something not so fantastically exciting about the IT department?
No, actually, we could also add software development to that list because we find that a lot of women engineers do enter IT companies in pure application development or software development positions. IT companies, IT departments in BFSI, we find very few women because it is a combination of both, which is software and hardware. And hardware, though I mean, engineers also don't want to, women engineers don't want to be branded as, you know, a nuts and bolts kind of an engineer. So perhaps that is the reason that they are not there. The other reason perhaps could be because typically, by and large, the teams are mostly male. So you are going to be one of the very few women within the technology team. That could be the reason why there are very few women in the IT functions in these companies.
And I'm going to just add to that, Vijay. You pointed out a third of the people, they're engineers, but they take up, you know, roles in marketing and HR and stuff like that. I think if you dig a little deeper, we'd probably find that's true for men as well as women. If you see the hordes of people who come out of engineering, you know, and even out of premier IIT institutes, a very large number of them are getting into banking finance, not into the IT part of it. So I suspect that part is same for men and women. The part where the pipeline, you know, gets thin is because the women are not entering the workforce. After doing the education, we seem to be losing, like pointed out, maybe a third of them. And I think that's the gap that we have to fill. We have to encourage people that, like Kirti said, if you've gone through the education, you've had that opportunity, so you better use it.
Dr. Ramachandran, you used to be on the board of IIT Kanpur. Did other IITs or any other engineering institutions doing something to push more women in? Is that one way of solving the pipeline for education, or is this something that women at the college level stage just have to make a conscious choice for themselves?
Latest statistic shows two of the IITs, the current IITs, the women were literally 50%, and they exceeded the number in one case. So numbers are going up. There are more women entering the IITs on the engineering side. But I think in the board, I always used to ask, what happens to them? Are they keeping track of where do they go? Because they have a very strong IIT alumni association, you know. So, but I don't think it is as strong as we are really hearing about, you're expecting, because nobody keeps track of what happens to women, and we don't blame anybody for that. I think women themselves need to be more conscious about what they want to do after this education. But it's the first few years, as somebody was mentioning, and which is true for any other career, it's also true for engineering, that is the time after graduation they pick up the first job. And the employer always will be looking at the performance of the employee in the first few years as to what is the caliber, is the person a high flyer, dependable, can produce results or not. And that's the most crucial period in the life of a woman also, in terms of her getting married and then bringing up a family. So the first 4 to 5 years, which is a critical period for assessment, is also a critical phase in her own life. So there are not many who are able to sustain that. So even a recent survey in the public undertaking has shown that while there is a large increase in the first entry level of women, but those who are able to sustain at a higher level, it breaks after the first five years, and those who are still able to limp and go up, they go into the higher management level and go forward. But the problem I think we are facing more is what happens at the higher management level, because we don't have women in the board. Very few, minuscule number, very small numbers. And the main factor is that the critical mass is getting lost in the early part of the career of the woman. And unless that critical mass is built, there has to be a deliberate effort, both on the part of women as well as the management's, because it's an issue of diversity. Talent is not gender sensitive. So we are losing a great talent and a great human resource potential. And to maximize gains for the economy, I think it's very important that this segment is brought in the mainstream of the development process.
Kirti, you know, one of the things that when we were talking earlier, you said, sure, the pipeline is small, but it's not like you can mandate 10% or 20% or 30% of your team should be women. And you would look at people irrespective of gender, based purely on merit. How do you really go about putting together a team, and what have you done in your own team?
To be gender, spoke to you about, gender doesn't matter, okay, because it's finally the performance of that individual that matters. So while there is statistics which has shown that gender diversity will improve the performance of the team, we really don't go out of the way to recruit women for the sake of recruiting women, okay? And like you said, you know, can we mandate that 10% of the workforce has to be women? We can do that provided we have a good pipeline, because we don't want to be forced to take women who are not capable of doing that job but are taken only because they are women.
Perfect. Aruna, similar thoughts?
Absolutely. You know, business is so competitive today. You want to do the best, meet your targets, and so you have to pick the best person for the job. You know, you're not going to pick a woman if there's a better male who can do it, and conversely, you're not going to drop a woman just because she is a woman. So I think, you know, just the competition in business is just going to make sure that you get the best person for the role.
Okay. One.
Make a comment on that. It's interesting because social science says that equal distribution between male and female in a team does lead to better performance. And, you know, diversity is important, whether it's women, different cultures, different age groups. And, you know, what I think is actually relevant about that is that it's about having a diverse team. It's about having different strengths and weaknesses. So when you're actually forming a team and getting a team to perform, it's good to have people that come from different perspectives and have different skills and capabilities. So, you know, putting together that team, I think diversity is important. It's not necessarily about male and female. It's about diversity as well as about putting together a team that's actually going to function well.
Yeah, in fact, there's a McKinsey study which went across the world, and it had 72% of its respondents who were executives across gender who said that Getting that diversity in leads to better business results. Do you also see that?
Sure, absolutely. I think on a different scale, Panchayat Raj, where we have had 33%, and now that was by law, and today by election process, the women have come in certain panchayats even above 50%, and though it's not a law. So why is it happening? So there are people who are voting for women. No, so it's not really the man-women issue. It is the diversity issue. They have different ways of looking at things. And just like we are talking of gender diversity, there are different types of diversities. So what we're trying to bring is that, as Melissa was telling, there are global statistics available, economies all over the world, where we have more women in the workforce, it has got better GDP growth. So we don't need to really debate too much on that issue. The question is, How does it happen? It's happening at the lower level, but I think it's not correct to assume that women will be picked up, even though women are not not by merit. It's not true. Everybody will get picked up only by merit. But the question is, why is it not happening? So it's availability also. There is also women themselves are laid back, you know, for various reasons that we have already discussed. So when advertisements are there, when selection process happens, there are not women, many women available for selection for people to do. So that's why the critical mass has to be built. Now, one can have different methods. Norway is a very advanced country even till today. They have introduced 50% for all the corporate sector in the board, the women, one director to be there. So on the lighter side, I will end up by giving a very interesting anecdote. I was in the oil sector in ONGC for about 10 years, more than 10 years. Norwegian oil company, state oil company, is called Statoil. And you will be very surprised that quite recently only, they have made the women were allowed to go to the rigs, offshore rigs. Till about 15 years ago, 20 years ago, women were not allowed to go to the rigs. Okay. So the chairman of the Statoil company, when we were actually working something together, so he was sharing that information with me jokingly that, oh, for the first time in Norway, we allowed the women in the workforce, in the Statoil. But you know, such a dramatic electrifying effect on the rigs. The men were shaving regularly. Men were better looking. Men were more energetic. So it was a positive impact on the whole work environment, let us say. So it's a fact. So it's a professionally, otherwise also, they bring in a different type of talent in at the workplace, both in terms of analytical skills, in terms of their, let's say, the patience, the aspirational factors of the people, the psychological factors, which men would think in a different way, she will think in a different way. I mean, we see that, we see a sample of that at home. A mother and father, I mean, we see different people at home, our own family members, how they react to different situations. So it is a well-established factor that, as Melissa said, that bringing gender diversity will help. The question is, how do you make it happen? We don't say it should be forced into making it happen. But I think it's a realization, and we are losing out a huge potential. And when women are entering the engineering colleges, the IITs, they are not entering for any other reason. They are entering because they are good. So when they pass out from there, they're obviously good. So when they go to the workplace, they should get selected only because they are good. So that factor is taken for granted. But beyond that, whether she is interested to continue, what kind of career she is able to build, what kind of social factors are probably hampering the growth process. No, these are some things which may or may not be within her control. You know, so that depends on individual family situation, individual factors, and some of them who are able to somehow march through, they are able to make it happen. Yeah.
Sure. Before we wrap up, any last thoughts? Melissa, we'll start with you.
Sure, I think we're all the same in some respects. Your destiny is up to you. And, you know, I don't think it matters whether you're male or female. You need to grasp the opportunities that you're given, and you need to have diversity in your team, because that ultimately leads to a better result for the organization.
I don't know.
Right. As Melissa says, I think each one is their own individual. And we were talking to some of the women over here in the audience earlier, and they pointed out that in some cases it's actually a case of positive bias. I don't see a negative bias. Sometimes it is even a positive bias. So it's up to us to embrace the skills that we have, the extra, what shall I say, advantages that we bring, and use those to, you know, if necessary, make up for any things that we cannot do because our priorities are kind of different.
Kithi?
So I second their thoughts completely. The only one thing that I would say is that it is not so rosy as it seems to be. We still have to put in that extra effort as women, but it's not impossible. So the woman has to strive to reach where she wants to be.
Yeah, and here's hoping that the next year around, when AMC Forum happens, We don't just have the women up on the panel, we have them in the audience as well. Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please put a huge round of applause for the ladies. I think they've done a fantastic job. Brilliant insights given. Thank you, Vijay. May I also request Mr. Chris Lee, Vice President Marketing, APJ, to come up on stage and felicitate our lovely ladies. Thank you, Vijay. There you have it, Lingan. Please give them a huge round of applause. Thank you, Chris. Thank you for doing the honors for us.